What's up, geeks, and welcome to the channel. In this video, we are going to cover the differences between Java's string, string builder, and string buffer by comparing their different usages and implementing several string operations. So let's get to it. First, I want to start with a quick comparison between the string builder and string buffer, because they are kind of very similar. They basically do the exact same thing. What differs between them is that string buffer is synchronized, whereas string builder isn't. This will lead to a degradation of performance on the string buffer's side. How much of a degradation? Not really a big deal in single-threaded environments, thanks to JVM optimizations. So whenever you want to use the advantages of the string builder, which we will discuss in just a minute, and you require your operations to be thread safe, then you must use string buffer, because string builder won't work in multi-threaded environments unless you make it. Now to the main event, the differences between a string and string builder. The major distinction between the two is that strings are immutable, which means that every time we change their value or perform any kind of operation that may induce change on them, it creates a new string in the memory where this information or change is stored. On the other hand, string builders are mutable, which means that any change induced on them will change the existing sequence of characters created by the string builder in the memory. Take a look at this example. We created both a string and a string builder from the word like. Then we concatenated the words and subscribe to this word using methods provided by both the string and the string builder. However, when we print the output to the console, you can see that in the case of the string, nothing was appended, and only the word like was printed out. Whereas, in case of the string builder, we printed the words like and subscribe as expected. That's what mutability is about. When we modified the string builder, the existing value in the memory was modified as well, and that's what was printed out. However, when we modified the string, a new string was created in the memory to store the newly generated value. But this created string was never used in this example. Therefore, to retrieve the created string, we will have to store the result of the concatenation inside a new string reference. And printing this value will result in the like and subscribe sentence. Now to dive deeper into this topic, let's take a look at the operations provided by both the string and string builder. Length and char at. Basically, a string is a sequence of characters, and if we want to retrieve the length of a string or a specific character at a given index, and whether we use string or the string builder for these operations, both will be very fast and will take O of 1 time complexity. The distinction between string and string builder appears when we are trying to extract a specific substring from a given sequence of characters, or when we are trying to concatenate or append additional characters to a given sequence of characters. For the substring case, in pre-Java 7, it was better to use strings, because as strings are immutable, the substring method actually only had to build a new string and reference with it the same underlying subchar array based on the indices that we have chosen. However, if this operation is done with a string builder, after choosing the indices of the characters required, we will have to loop over all of them to store them in a new string and return it. Because you see, this string builder operation returns a string and not a string builder. But all of that was pre-Java 7. After this version of Java, the substring operation in strings also became an O of n time complexity operation, n being the number of characters in the substring, as it was also copying the extracted characters from the string into a new string. Now, concerning concatenation, it is preferable to use string builders. Strings are immutable. Every time you are trying to concatenate a new character to our given string, a new string will have to be created. So, we will have to traverse the existing string to copy its characters to the newly created one, on top of the desired sequence of characters we want to append, which of course will have to be traversed to be added to the created string. So the time complexity will be O of m plus n, m being the length of our initial string, and n the length of the string to be concatenated. Whereas, in the case of a string builder, as we are performing the operation directly on the initial sequence of characters, we just have to append the desired sequence of characters at the end. So we start from the last index and traverse only the desired string to be concatenated, which leaves us with the O of n time complexity, n being the length of the string to be concatenated, or O of 1 if we are trying to add only one character. After this, you may ask, well, why don't we always use String Builder if we are using a post-Java 7 version? Well, because the main difference does not lie in the performance, as I previously said, it lies in the immutability. And sometimes it is the immutability we need regardless of the performance drawback. Therefore, to make things clearer, let's take a look at different string operations you may encounter using both the string and the string builder. And while doing that, we will try to further answer the question, when should we use strings and when should we use string builders? The first operation we are going to talk about is reversing a string. To reverse a string, we have to loop over the characters of this given string in reverse order and store the characters in a new variable. Now the question is if this variable should be a string or a string builder. If we use the string.concat method or the plus sign, our method will look something like this. And this complexity will be O of n squared, because the for loop traverses all the characters of the string, that is n characters, and the concat method is of the order of O of n. That makes O of n times n, which is O of n squared. However, if we use the string builder, our reverse method will look something like that. And because the append method here takes constant time to complete, or O of 1, then the overall complexity is only O of n. So, to traverse a string, it is actually better to use the string builder, and because of that, the string builder class provides us with a reverse method that will reverse the string for us, and it does exactly the same thing we did with our for each loop. The next widely used operation we are going to talk about is retrieving the suffixes of a given string. The suffixes of a string are the set of all possible substrings that can be derived from a particular string, starting from the end of the string. So the suffixes of the string geekific, for example, are the substrings you can see in front of you. In code, to extract these substrings, we will first need to create a list of strings to store them. And then, while looping over our given string, extract all the possible sets of substrings using the substring method. Now, this isn't the most optimal way in terms of time complexity to solve the suffixes problem. It is usually done with the help of trees. However, in this video, we are interested in the strings and string builders part. And we previously mentioned that when it comes to substrings, they act similarly. So why are we using strings here? Why not use string builders, as we did for the reverse method? Well, first, replacing the text variable we have with a new instance of the string builder that does exactly the same thing is pretty useless. We will just be creating string builder instances in the memory with no added value. In addition to this, the list of suffixes we are returning may be used by several parts of our application, and modifications may be applied on this list. So, if we were to return a list of string builders defined at the level of the class instead of strings, and one part of our application decided to modify a string builder inside it, then the suffixes will be modified in the memory. Hence, everyone making use of this method will also see the modification. However, because of the string's immutability, if we were to modify a string inside the list, a new string will be created for it. The upcoming operation is very similar to that of the suffixes, as it retrieves the prefixes of a given string. Their code snippets are also very much alike, as you can see. The difference is that instead of setting the fixed boundary of the extracted substrings to the end of the array, we set it to be at the beginning of the array. Now what if we didn't want to find the prefixes of one string, but instead we want given two strings to find the longest common prefix between them? Let's take these two strings or sentences as an example. You can see that the longest common prefix between them is the word like. How are we going to retrieve this common prefix given two strings? Well, we will have to simultaneously loop over both strings and compare the characters located at the same indices to check if these characters are equal. And if they are, then this common length between the two is increased by 1. When we hit the two non-matching characters, we return the longest common prefix. In code, this simultaneous loop is represented by a while loop that will keep increasing the common length as long as the characters located at the same indices match, and as long as we haven't reached the end of one of the strings, which string between the two, the one having the least number of characters or the smaller length. And this is translated in code using the math.min function. Finally, after exiting the while loop, the substring ranging from index 0 of any of the two strings till this common prefix is returned. This last operation that we are going to cover in this video is an operation that will make use of a couple others we just implemented. This operation is the longest repeated substring. What this operation does is, given a string or an entire text, it will return for us the longest repeated word inside it or the longest repeated substring. Let's say that the method we are going to implement is provided with this paragraph. Then it will return for us the word video as it is the longest repeated substring in it. The difference between this and the method we just implemented is that the repeated word can be located anywhere in the string and not just at the beginning. The first step in finding the most repeated substring in a text is retrieving the suffixes of the given text and sorting these suffixes. To do that, we can make use of the method we previously implemented on top of the collections.sort. Next, we need to loop over these sorted suffixes, and for every two adjacent suffixes, we need to find the longest common prefix. We will start with an empty string as the longest common prefix and update it as we find a longer string or prefix. It is very similar to finding a maximum or minimum inside an array, except this time the comparison is based on the output of the longest common prefix method we implemented instead of a simple integer or alphabetical comparison. And finally, the retrieved longest repeated substring is returned to the user. So, that's it for this video. I hope it was helpful. Thank you guys for watching. Take care, and I will see you on the next one.